Thank you so much. Joan, and I have a proposal for you, which is that since you have such a fantastic audience, why don't we just declare this conference a success now and then go and have a good time out there. It will spare me the agony of actually having to make this presentation. And I'm just very grateful to be here and to be able to join this conference, reconnect with old colleagues. What I'll try to do is really try to combine a little bit of the work that I'm doing at the moment and connect it a bit with the theme of the conference, which is inclusive and sustainable growth. I'm currently working on two book projects. The first one is on this idea of resistance to new technologies, trying to understand why is it so that we have so many challenges, but also so many technological opportunities, but at the height of really being able to search for solutions, we have also seen heightened opposition to new technologies. That's the first book. And I've been working on that book for a decade. And the second book project is really trying to figure out how nations succeed. We hear a lot about why nations fail, and I was most interested in a kind of drawing inspirational lessons from previous experiences, historical experiences, why, and particularly how nations succeed. I'm interested mostly in how things get done. These are two projects I'm working on simultaneously at the moment. The second one really has been inspired by my interest in really thinking through what's happening on the African continent. So I'll have Africa as a reference point, but I also just want to give a caveat from the outset that I do understand the diversity of the continent, how big it is. So even though I'll be using the word Africa, I'm aware that it's fairly large enough. You can fit the United States in there, Western Europe, China, India, Argentina, and have sufficient room to sneak in England. So it's a fairly big continent. So I'm aware of that. So even when I use the word Africa, I'm conscious of the fact that we're thinking about a landmass that is three times the size of the United States. I really more recently I've been working on this book. By the way, the entire text of the book is available online. And when doing this book on agriculture, I was really focusing very much on how to think about agriculture as an innovative entrepreneurial activity. And one thing kind of became evident to me, which is that I published the book in 2011, which also happens to be the 100 years after Schumpeter published his book, The Theory of Economic Development. And I started to think, why is it so that the theory of economic development put together by Schumpeter 100 years ago really has hardly been used as an organizing framework for thinking about development in the developing countries, so in the low-income countries? And there are many reasons that have been given in the past. One is Schumpeter wrote in a very circuitous and convoluted way, therefore his work was not accessible. There are other arguments that he essentially, because his books were published before the First World War and the Second World War, therefore they were not accessible to low-income countries. That every argument has been given to try to show why Schumpeter wasn't really a source of inspiration for thinking about development policy in low-income countries. And it didn't make sense to me, so I started digging up a little bit. And found out, to my great surprise, that the reason why Schumpeter is not taken as a starting point for thinking about development is not accidental. There were very extensive debates that lasted over a decade between 1952 and 1956, where the creators of present-day economic development theory basically argued that Schumpeter's thinking was not relevant for low-income countries. Issues of entrepreneurship, industrial development were not relevant. This was a very extensive debate, so the fact that Schumpeter is not really featuring as a source of ideas is not an accident. It's a consequence of an academic exercise in scholarly journals and books to demonstrate that entrepreneurship and innovation were not relevant for low-income countries. Now, this affected mostly African countries. Much of this was being driven through the United Nations system, and the overall argument was that what was needed for low-income countries or underdeveloped countries, as they were called then, was basically a strong planning hand of the government and not entrepreneurship or emphasis on entrepreneurs as a drivers of economic transformation. And so that's what I really wanted to do this morning, is just to share with you my views about how we might think about Schumpeter today, 100 years following the publication of his very important book. His idea of innovation, which is familiar to most of you, the very simple but a very powerful concept that innovation is really a result of combinations, that is creation of new combinations. And those combinations are expressed whether it's in products, processes, raw materials, organizational methods, or development of new markets. These are all self-evident when you think about what's happening in low-income countries, but yet this very powerful theoretical framework for understanding and organizing public policy really was never made available to countries that actually needed it most. Of course, when Schumpeter published his book, it was immediately very controversial, when his own mentors basically disagreed with him. He wrote somewhere that it received fatal acclaim right from the outset. So it was controversial even then. Interestingly enough, in 2005, there was a publication of a paper by Schumpeter was discovered. He wrote it in 1932, where he tried to really clarify his thinking basically around three core concepts, the idea of uncertainty. And then he elaborated a bit on the concept of combinations, and I'll get back to the idea of combinations later on. And this third concept, which is discontinuous leaps, which has given us, in fact, a better understanding of thinking about technological leapfrogging. All these ideas had been foreshadowed by Schumpeter. In fact, many low-income countries, particularly in Africa, are rediscovering them, but through a roundabout way of looking at South Asian economies that basically learned from Japan's own development was to a large degree congruent with Schumpeter's thinking. But you can go back and find exactly the same ideas in Schumpeter's original ideas. The debates really started in 1952 with the publication of a book by Ragnar Nukse, which was basically grappling with the idea of how you build, how you create large-scale capital formation in underdeveloped countries. He believed that the only way to move beyond the inertia of underdevelopment was to embark on large-scale industrial development. This is the theory of the big push. And his view is that if you build large-scale industries, those industries will not only transform the economy and generate wealth, but the technologies derived from the first core set of industries will diffuse in the economy and help to transform other sectors as well. That was Nukse's thinking at the time. His book is an Estonian economist. In fact, there's an Institute on Innovation and Governance in Estonia named after him that's still advancing his thinking. This view went counter to the thinking of a lot of people at the time who are trying to establish programs, particularly within the United Nations, on how to deal with low-income countries. The book came out in 1953. Just prior to the publication of the book, a very well-known American economist, Henry Wallach, published a paper basically trying to preempt Nooks's book by arguing that really this is Schumpeter is not relevant for developing countries because one, entrepreneurship is not really the mode, the driving force for the economies of poor countries. Secondly, innovation was not a standard form of practice. And finally, poor countries were not interested in personal enrichment. So you needed a different framework for thinking about it. Now, this is a very influential person who sat on the Federal Reserve Bank, so was basically responsible for allocating resources. This was the beginnings of the United Nations when funding was needed to support technical assistance programs, so his views really counted. And he goes into great detail. I have a full paper on this that will be available later on. Then there are other leading economists who also just thought that Schumpeter had nothing to do with the development. Arthur Lewis being one of them, quickly dismissed him and published his own theory of economic growth as opposed to development. Schumpeter had a lot to say about the difference between growth and development. The fact that Arthur Lewis would move on to get a Nobel Prize was basically reconfirmation of a view that was really not consistent with the way Schumpeter had envisaged the role of innovation and development. What surprised me a little bit in looking at the material was the very important role that Hans Singer played. Hans Singer joined and worked for the United Nations for about 22 years. And he basically dismissed in a very famous and very influential 1953 paper, dismissed Schumpeter and argued basically that Schumpeter's thinking was irrelevant to developing countries for a very simple reason, which is that the emerging countries were so far behind technologically that it didn't make sense to introduce any new technologies available today in the economies. And his thinking was that if you introduced new technologies, they would displace the limited employment that was being generated at the time. But he even went further and said that they need probably technologies that are about 100 years old. And then he concluded that those technologies don't exist anymore. So it's a very pessimistic view of what he thought about the prospects of technology for development. He later on revised his position a little bit, but what's instructive here is that Hans Singer was a student of Schumpeter's. And that's really interesting. Moved on, of course, left Germany and moved to Cambridge, worked with Keynes. Also incredibly dismissive. Now, his paper is important for one other reason, which was that Hans Singer was at the center of the creation of United Nations agencies that were translating this view of derived development, that since developing countries didn't have the capacity for endogenous growth, what you needed was technical assistance to basically support experts to go to developing countries and help them solve their problems. That became the dominant model. And so what we ended up having is essentially the creation of new institutions around this idea of technical assistance that assumed that emerging countries were incapable of endogenous economic development. And that became essentially the paradigm that defined much of the low-income countries, particularly African countries. Southeast Asian countries took on a different role because they had Japan as a teacher next door. So Japan was a role model for them. Whereas African countries, the Caribbean and others, had to look very much, and of course Latin American countries, very much to the United Nations as a source of inspiration and models on how to develop. The debates continued. I think the last really important publication on this appeared in 1965. So we had a nearly 15 years of leading players arguing that Schumpeter was not relevant for development. And so it should not come as a surprise that when it took so long, say for the African countries particularly, to start thinking about the role of the private sector and technological innovation in development. There are more kind of nuances around it that I don't want to go into, which include an attempt by Hans Singer, guided by this view of derived development, advancing this concept of technology transfer, particularly within the UN system through the Sussex Group, that had a big influence on the way the United Nations actually thinks about, not just thinks, but acts on a development questions. And so essentially what we saw over that period in terms of the intellectual debates at the time was an obvious rejection of Schumpeter on three accounts. One is that there were no entrepreneurs, and secondly, there were no innovations coming from developing countries. And here, Schumpeter's critics thought of innovation in terms of technological innovation, not in the way Schumpeter thought about innovation, which is the transformation of the economic system through the creation of new economic combinations. They thought about it as technology. And of course, thirdly, this is an idea that came from Wallach, basically saying developing countries are only concerned with their biggest preoccupation is increasing consumption. Schumpeter's view is about production. Therefore, Schumpeter is irrelevant to poor countries whose job is really to consume, which means basically consuming imported products. And economists in the audience, you can connect that to the product cycle theory that fits very well with that kind of thinking at the time. So effectively, Schumpeter was rejected. It isn't that people didn't know about his work. His work was known, was debated, and was concluded that it was irrelevant. And I actually don't know of any leading theorist in economics or in development whose work has been discussed and considered irrelevant for development. Usually you have combinations of different ideas being commingled, but in the case of Schumpeter, it was an outright rejection of his thinking. And that brings me to today on how we might want to think about Schumpeter, because I don't want us to think that we have to go back to exactly to his writings. What he's done is basically provided us with inspirational models on how to think about development, and especially for those of us who are concerned with the innovation and entrepreneurship for inclusive and sustainable development today. The first area that really comes again out of Schumpeter's work is this notion of technological abundance, in that when you do these combinations, you may start off with a small number of technological options, but through combinations, you get up with a much wider range of options. Think of it as playing a game of Scrabble, in that you have a set of letters. The letters are limited in number, but you can create so many different types of words. And secondly, this knowledge expands exponentially, and this is extremely important, particularly for latecomer economies, that it's through this exponential growth in knowledge which allows latecomers to inherit much larger pools of scientific and technical knowledge than their predecessors, that drives this rapid technological catch-up. And this is a very basic principle that guides all in evolutionary processes, but it's even more dramatic in the case of technological innovation. You take mobile phones as a really very good example of that. We call them mobile phones not because you carry them around, but in fact because the first mobile phone created by Ericsson in 1956, somebody said, let's call it mobile telephone A. That's why we call mobile phones today. But it weighed 42 kilos. You couldn't possibly carry it around. But over time, you started to see, because of this phenomenon of exponential growth in technical knowledge, you started to see both expansion and capabilities, but also miniaturization of it, until you get into the real phases of real abundance in terms of just diversity of variants of mobile phones. And you can even trace lineages technological lineages. This is just from Nokia. If you look very carefully from the 1980s, they're producing like one or two mobile phones, and you get into the 2007, you can see the increase in the diversity of products that they're actually putting on the market. And you can draw the same map for almost every major mobile company. And the second area that really interests me a lot is the area of the life sciences. Again, we see the same phenomenon with a dramatic reduction in the sequencing of genomes. And as this takes place, you have just huge amounts of genetic information available in the public domain that allows for the emergence of radically new industries. If you take the human genome as an example, it's now estimated that for every dollar that the US invested in the Human Genome Project, it's added roughly $178 to the US economy. It's just the US economy alone. It was developed initially as a program on human health, but as you can see there, the applications are extending into so many other areas of economic effort in energy, industrial biotechnology, food and agriculture, forensic medicine, zoology, anthropology, and others. So again, we see this is again another example of this consequence of the creation of new combinations. The next frontier for this is nanotechnology. My drives are not working here. I'll just skip this. Nanotechnology is another example of that, where very simple modifications at the nano level, just like adding boron to a carbon nanotube structure, it starts to give you properties in material that don't normally exist in nature, which on one hand, it attracts oil, on the other hand, it repels water. And this is being done by young people, students in various universities, that allows you to do radically new things, especially for environmental management that you couldn't do in the past. Water repellent fabrics, you can go to Thailand today and buy shirts you don't have to wash very often because it doesn't get stained. You also have the reverse of that, new materials that are super absorbent materials that will capture water, and you can re-establish agriculture in places that are usually very dry. And these are very minor, technically very minor modifications in various structures of materials that have huge economic consequences. The second area that again goes back to Schumpeter's thinking is really thinking of economies as ecosystems. Again, to this audience, I don't have to belabor this point, but we had again an unfortunate historical development with Schumpeter's first book having included a chapter 7, that viewed economies as ecosystem. Much of what we think about complexity economics today, in fact, can be traced back to Schumpeter's chapter 7, which was excluded from later publications of his book, and only recently got rediscovered. So some of these ideas of really thinking about economies as ecosystems date back to Schumpeter's thinking. And the third area that interests me a great deal is this, when Schumpeter wrote, one of the reasons he thought very much about this radical transformation of economic systems was because he was thinking about railroads. When a railway gets established, it clearly transforms small cities into large-scale cities. His ideas about entrepreneurship were very much organized around looking at what was happening with the introduction of railroads, both in Europe and in America. And you can think, another way of thinking about railroads is think about it as infrastructure. That if you think about large-scale infrastructure projects have exactly the same kinds of transformational impact as Schumpeter observed with railroads. Power supply is a good example of that. My apologies to any colleagues here who are connected to Nigeria. I was actually offered this by a colleague of mine from Nigeria who said, I now have evidence as to why power goes off every now and then in Nigeria. But if you think about energy, transportation, telecommunications, and irrigation, those areas basically have the same kind of transformational impact on economic systems as Schumpeter observed essentially in regard to railroads. And for me, the best example of that is the area of fiber optic cables. If you look carefully, say on the East Coast, if you look carefully, this was 2009, June 2009, this entire section of the East Coast of Africa had no connection to high-speed internet. But the trends give you an indication of what's likely to happen. You see, again, exponential drop in the cost of laying fiber optic cables. This is what Africa looks like in just 4 years. Again, big leaps in capabilities, but also in the creation of radically new industries that never existed in Africa only 3 years ago. The level of investment is also particularly striking in that we have just around the continent, somewhere in the neighborhood of $5 billion invested in fiber optic cables. And the terrestrial investments just on the Eastern and Southern Africa alone is in the neighborhood of $7 billion. This has happened over a very short period. Most of that investment is actually from African investors. Again, you have here a very good example of a dramatic impact of radical technologies that transform the economic system. The third area is the area of human capabilities, and I don't want to belabor this point, but I want to stress the importance of training in the engineering sciences. That what has made a difference for most countries is putting resources in building engineering schools. And this is one of those areas where developing countries really have, particularly low-income countries, have been weakest. Finally, I wanted to just mention the role of the state. This is an important and much debated point that in all these activities, in fact, Schumpeter wrote a very interesting paper about entrepreneurship in which he drew an analogy between an entrepreneur and a leader, that leaders and entrepreneurs are actually do exactly the same thing, which is work on new things, developing new things. And so for me, the purpose of a head of state, for example, is not just to sit there and look pretty. They actually have to do new things. And so these ideas basically give us at least a way of reflecting on Schumpeter's thinking. And basically, we've seen it being done to great effect through the Globalics Network, which is really the most elaborate effort today of bringing these ideas to bear on policymaking in particularly low-income countries. And this is a network whose influence, I think, will go a long way, not only in bringing us back to these very interesting ideas, but also helping to renew the thinking and expand them. My plea is that we've moved from the rejection of Schumpeter. This might be a time, actually, to flip the switch. In that we see all around the world that his ideas are now gaining in prominence. And I hope that this conference could add a little bit to that thinking as well. So thank you again for the opportunity to have me here, and I look forward to the next couple of days.